JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFT's daily market review for December the 10th. I am Charalambos, Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFT, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded higher against all but two of the other G10 currencies on Wednesday during the Asian session Thursday. It gained the most versus NOK, Kiwi, SEK, and the Japanese yen in that order, while it underperformed only against the Aussie. The greenback was found virtually unchanged against the Canadian dollar. The strengthening of the US dollar and the weakening of the Kiwi suggest that the markets turned risk off at some point yesterday. However, the strengthening of the Aussie and the weakening of the Japanese yen point otherwise. Thus, in order to get a clearer picture with regards to the broader market sentiment, we prefer to turn our gaze to the equity world. Here, major EU indices were mixed, but in the US, all of the three major ones closed in negative waters, with Nasdaq falling the most, -1.19%. The soft appetite rolled somewhat over into the Asian session today as well. Although China's Shanghai composite was found virtually unchanged, Japan's Nikkei 225, Hong Kong's Hang Seng, and South Korea's KOSPI slid 0.23, 0.57, and 0.33% respectively. It seems that the optimism around the coronavirus aid package in the US has faded, with the US Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell saying that lawmakers were still looking for a path towards an agreement. Overnight, the US Congress approved a stopgap government funding bill to prevent a government shutdown this week, but they were unable to find common ground over a COVID relief package. Now, it remains to be seen whether they can indeed agree on that before year end. Nonetheless, the key question is not when they will agree, but how large the package will eventually be. Last week, $908 billion bipartisan plan gained momentum in the Congress, but with McConnell pushing to keep relief spending near $500 billion, the package could still fall short of expectations. In any case, this has not changed our view. Yes, the disappointment may allow for some further correction in equities, but eventually the vaccine prospects combined with the Biden presidency in the US may result in a rebound and the continuation of the prevailing uptrend. In the currency world, this means higher risk-linked currencies like the Aussie and the Kiwi, and lower safe havens, the likes of the US dollar and the Japanese yen. Speaking about currencies, the pound slid overnight after UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson and EU Commission President Ursula von der Leyen failed to reach consensus and just agreed to continue negotiations until the end of the weekend. This means that there will be no trade deal presented in the EU summit starting today. So with the clock ticking towards the December 31st deadline for sealing a deal over trade, anything suggesting that the two sides are still finding it hard to bridge their differences could push the pound lower. For the pound to rebound strongly, headlines pointing towards consensus are needed. Yesterday, we also had a Bank of Canada interest rate decision. The bank kept its interest rates and its QE purchases unchanged, noting that the rebound in the global and Canadian economies has unfolded largely as the bank anticipated in its October monetary policy report. Officials acknowledge that the positive vaccine news is providing some reassurance, but they added that the pace and breadth of the global rollout of vaccinations remain uncertain. They also said that economic momentum heading into the fourth quarter appears to be stronger than expected in October, but in recent weeks, the imposition of restrictions can be expected to weigh on growth in the first quarter of 2021. In our view, this was a neutral statement, and that's why the Canadian dollar stayed largely unfazed. Moving ahead, we expect the commodity-linked currency to be mainly driven by developments surrounding the broader market sentiment and especially movements in oil prices. Now, as for today, the central bank talks will be passed to the ECB. When they last met, the policymakers of this bank said that in December, the new macroeconomic projections will allow a thorough reassessment of the economic outlook and that they will recalibrate their instruments as appropriate. In other words, they hinted that they are very likely to expand their stimulative efforts at this gathering. Expectations are for a 500 billion euros expansion of their QE purchases, and thus, if this is the case, the euro is unlikely to move much. For the common currency to move higher, the bank has to disappoint, namely to deliver less stimulus than what the market currently anticipates. That said, with the euro already well above 120 against its US counterpart, and inflation in the bloc staying in negative waters, the last thing the ECB would like is further appreciation of its currency. Therefore, we see more chances for policymakers to over-deliver than to under-deliver. We believe that there is a decent chance for expanding QE by more than expected and also talking down the euro, either through the meeting statement or President Lagarde's post-decision press conference. As for the rest of today's events, during the early European morning, we already got the UK's monthly GDP for October alongside the industrial and manufacturing production rates for the month. Although the GDP slowed to 0.4% month over month from 1.1%, both the industrial and manufacturing production year over year rates came in better than expected. In any case, the pound barely reacted on the releases, confirming our view that GDP traders keep their gaze mostly locked on developments surrounding Brexit. Later in the day, the US CPIs for November are coming out. Both the headline and core rates are expected to have ticked down to 1.1 and 1.5% year over year from 1.2 and 1.6% respectively, with the Fed noting that it will allow inflation to overshoot its 2% target for some time so that inflation averages 2% over time. Well below target readings may increase the chances for the Fed to expand its stimulus efforts at its upcoming gathering. The initial jobless claims for last week are also due to be released. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the Weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 8 o'clock AM GMT. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.